This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised.
Hey guys, Sean Fay Wolf of Diamondback Studios here, and damn it, I missed this. I don't know, maybe it's just because it seems like pop music has just taken a break from existing for the past few months, but revisiting the popular music of just 3 short years ago feels like a trip back to a different dimension. I've said this before, and I'll say it again. 2015 was not just an excellent year for the charts, it was a fascinating year. The electronica and club genres that dominated the first half of the decade polymerized with the genesis of the gloom and doom that dominated the second half of the decade to create an eclectic mix of pretty much every style, mood, and genre that you can think of, as well as several others that have yet to be explained or rationalized by science. And unlike 1992, where the amazing variety of good stuff was floating atop a sea of samey blandness, the bad music of 2015 is honestly even more mind-blowing than the good. While the running theme of my worst of 1992 list was me struggling to stay awake, the running theme of this list turned out to be me staring in slack-jawed disbelief at how anybody thought that what they were doing was a good idea. So without further ado, let's take a trip back in time to an era where the phrase President Donald Trump is about to spend several billion dollars on a national space force would rightfully make you sound like a lunatic as we count down.
Now watch me whip, kill it. Now watch me nay-nay.
Oh, okay.
Now watch me whip, watch me nay-nay.
Yeah. Why me do it?
Now watch me whip. Watch me, nay, nay.
Okay.
Watch my move up. Now he goes crank, crank.
Okay, so here I am, just a guy on the internet, choosing to talk about pop music in my free time. At the time of me making this video, I'm encroaching on 500 subscribers, and my most successful videos are getting a couple thousand views each. Those numbers have been growing at a steady rate, and hopefully they'll continue to do so, but let's be real, they're not anything groundbreaking. I'm still a very small channel. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not complaining about that. I'm honestly thrilled with the amount of progress that I've made in the short time that I've been doing this. And I genuinely want to thank every single one of you guys for watching and supporting me as I do this. I only bring it up because here I am, a tiny music review channel submerged deep within the ocean of YouTube, talking about some of the most successful musicians of my lifetime, and yet somehow I still feel like I'm punching down when I talk about these guys. Look, I'm sorry, I don't like putting ties on lists like this, but I genuinely can't decide which of these I like less, and I think you know as well as I do that it's not worth taking two separate spots on the list to talk about these two. I don't even know if I'd be capable of analyzing them separately from one another. They're both just pimples on the acne-inflamed forehead of the Vine song trend that thankfully seems to be on its way out nowadays. However, in 2015, 4 of these memetic song fragments managed to make their way onto the year-end list, which is at least 7 more than there should have been. Nasty Freestyle and Coco certainly aren't winners either, but I picked Watch Me and Hit the Quan because they were the biggest and least competent of them, respectively. Watch Me is just a boring slog from beginning to end, where Salento does nothing but name-check and demonstrate a bunch of dances, which is great if you're one of the 1.5 billion children who watch the song's music video, but really not much use to me when it comes on the radio in my car, which it did frequently enough to not only become the 8th biggest song of 2015, but to scrape onto the 2016 year-end list as well.
Now I mean bop, 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 bop.
I wouldn't give this song a second thought if I weren't forced to hear it so much, but the flat singing of this list of inane dances over one of the most basic, generically pathetic beats I've ever heard makes this completely useless for anything besides Baby's first dance song. By comparison, Hit the Quan does have a slightly more interesting beat, and I was never forced to hear it on the radio, but...
Buy paper chase, then vanish. Hit the Quan on her, make her boyfriend panic. I heart Memphis, but I...
Well, you can't say this guy didn't take inspiration from some of the most iconic musicians of our day.
Wake me up!
Wake me up inside!
I can't wake up!
Wake me up inside!
Save me!
The verses of Hit the Quan have the air of a kid writing random numbers on his math homework because he knows that the teacher isn't going to check it. He knew that the chorus was going to be the only part that was in the vines, so he didn't give an ounce of thought to the rest of it. The only reason that I Love Memphis made Hit the Quan... You know what, screw you. I Heart Memphis is not a rap name. It's the country station my aunt listens to when the oldie station is on commercial break. I'm not calling you that. The only reason that this guy made Hit the Quan was because the dance Rich Homie Quan did in Flex became a Vine meme, so he just made something as quickly as possible to capitalize on the trend, even naming the song after Rich Homie Quan. And you know what? Both of these songs may have been lucrative at the time, but they've consigned both of these guys to joke status for the rest of their lives. It honestly feels like I'm picking on a pair of third graders by making fun of some drawings they got gold stars on when they were in kindergarten. It just doesn't feel right. These guys are probably already embarrassed by these songs' existence, and both of their careers are long dead by now. I Love Memphis hasn't released anything in a year, and Salento actually just released an entire album of songs to his YouTube channel not too long ago, and of his nearly 4 million subscribers, only a few thousand of them even noticed. I think that that fact summarizes this situation better than I ever could with words. Now, I mentioned this before, but the biggest running theme of this list were songs that made me want to run up to the artist in question and yell, "What is wrong with you?
Why are you yelling at me?"
Now, for the most part, I don't have an answer to that question. Artists are strange people, and it's often impossible to tell what's really going on inside their minds. But for this particular entry, I think I've got a pretty good idea of what's going on inside this particular artist's head. Because in the words of the new season of BoJack,
"Am I Taylor Swift's grudge against Katy Perry right now? Because even though it makes no sense, I want to be held for a super long time." If you love like that, blood runs, 'cause baby, now we got bad blood. You know it used to be bad love, so take a look what you've done.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, let us discuss the phenomenon of Miss Taylor Swift. From the vantage point of 2018, the year where she ain't at her best and her reputation's never been worse. Listening to Bad Blood in 2018 is like watching a Trump rally from 2015. At the time, you might have been shocked, disgusted, and maybe a bit ironically amused that this was actually happening, but then you rolled your eyes and moved on with your life, assuring yourself that it was just a phase and that it would be over soon enough. But then, over the next few years, more and more hints started to drop that this was actually happening, and you convinced yourself that no, this couldn't be happening. It can't be allowed to happen. There is no way that this is actually the way that things are going. And then, all at once, the entire situation crashed down in an avalanche of chaos and despair as you realize that yes, this is the reality that we live in now, and we're all gonna have to spend the next few years suffering through it together. It's really bizarre that, out of the great variety of solid singles off of 1989, it would be Bad Blood that would dictate the next phase of Taylor Swift's career as an entertainer. Taylor Swift would no longer be defined by her sweetness, her relatability, her fun side, or even her vulnerable and emotional side. Instead, she would be defined as a defensive, catty, thin-skinned narcissist triggered by the mention of any of her many imperfections, who is incapable of the slightest bit of self-reflection or acceptance of her flaws. Even when Taylor inevitably backpedals on this approach with her next album, Reputation will still remain as a permanent scar on her discography that proves everything that her haters ever said about her true, and it all started with Bad Blood. And that's kind of funny to me, because if I'm being honest with myself, this song really isn't as bad as everybody always says it is. I mean, don't get me wrong, even out of context, this is still a bad song. This is easily the worst chorus of pre-Reputation Taylor's career, with its playground taunt of a melody and its awkward thudfest of a production. That said, it does get a lot more tolerable once the instrumentals kick in, and the verses aren't the worst thing in the world either. The version of this song that hit number one was the remix with Kendrick Lamar, and while this is one of the better guest verses of his career, it's still only about a 6.5 out of 10. I'd be lying if I said it didn't sound a bit clunky and out of place. By contrast, the original version of this song sounds more like a regular Taylor Swift song, with a melody and instrumentals that meld with the chorus and especially the pre-chorus way more effectively, but we still have to listen to Taylor going on and on about her Mean Girls-esque beef with Katy Perry and I just turn off. As far as I'm concerned, this isn't the worst thing in the world. It's just a very mediocre song with some really bad low points. I've seen so many other critics' worst of 2015 lists from a few years back where they went on and on about how awful this song was, how unlistenable it was, and what a bad picture it painted of Taylor Swift. And looking back at those videos now, the only thing that I can think is, oh, bless your virgin souls. When it gets to the point that the second line of your chorus directly contradicts your title, you have to wonder if it was intentional. I think the only song this year that tempted fate more than this one was Meghan Trainor's Lips Are Moving, which was one of my final cuts for this list, by the way. Boy, look at me in my face. Tell me that you're not just about this bass. I am not even slightly about this bass. I come from outer space. I believe you. And I'm a classy girl. Just keep telling yourself that. Go find somebody new. Nothing in the world would make me happier. Tell me, do you think I'm dumb? Extraordinarily so. I might be young. Ah, that was a fun barrel of fish. But now let's get back to Badoose and Sway Sway, or whatever cartoon characters those two are named after. I got some models that you see up in the movies and they wanna make a flick for the camera. Yeah? Wanna be Kim Kardashian. Hey. I was gonna let this one slide. I mean, sure, the song is slow, clunky, and droning, the lyrics are infantile and asinine, and these guys sound like Migos with their balls chopped off, but complaining about those things in a Ray Shremmert song is like complaining about a AAA game on launch day being full of glitches and microtransactions. If you're still choosing to give them money at this point, that's kind of on you. At least No Type has some of the better flows of Ray Shremmert's career, with a melody that does at least use dissonance in an interesting way, and I was never forced to hear it on the radio. So, honestly, I don't know if this song deserves to be on here. Is what I would have said if this video had been made 3 years ago, before Black Beatles hit. That girl is a real crowd, please. Small world, all her friends know of me. I know that people like to take pot shots at this song because these two squawking eunuchs decided to dub themselves the black version of the Beatles, and I agree that that was indeed a very bad idea. I'm sure their mom sent them to time out for that. However, despite the loaded title, I will still argue that Black Beatles is a pretty solid track, and it was this song, along with Power Glide from earlier this year, that finally helped me understand the appeal of Ray Shremmert. Say what you will about how well they do it, but one thing that Sway and Slim almost always do is completely throw themselves into whatever song they're on. Even today, in the typhoon of Xanax that is the modern rap scene, Ray Shremmert are some of the only rappers out there who sound like they're actually enjoying living in the moment. Combine that with the fact that they've done this without disguising their amateur-level vocal talents with too much autotune or studio effects, and they've essentially turned themselves into some of the best self-inserts that a young hip-hop fan could ask for. It's a lot easier for a kid to believe that they could be a famous rapper when those rappers sound exactly like they would if they got on the mic. I realize that that's probably the single most backhanded compliment in history, but I really do mean it. Ray Shremmert's youthful energy is their appeal, and their songs are only good when their music is as energetic as they are. This is why Black Beatles and Power Glide work, while No Flex Zone, Swang, and of course, No Type fail miserably. The beat is just too dour and monotonous to jam with, and not even the excitement in their voices as they rap out their ridiculous non-punchlines are enough to make this song any more appealing than a viscous pit of tar. Trust me, guys, regardless of what you might think, you do have a type that works for you. Stick to that in the future, please. Mamma mia! Harvey Freak, do the Harvey Freak. Yeah! Do the Harvey Freak, do the Harvey Freak. I'm gonna be upfront with you guys. I'm not gonna talk about this next one for long, because I really don't feel like I can, because I honestly have no idea why I dislike this so much. I have difficulty putting words to just why this guy gets under my skin, and even though I'm gonna try my best, I'm pretty sure that I'm still gonna come across as kind of irrational here. Because the fact is, even though this is a guy that most people seem to like, and I know that I'm not gonna be able to do a good job attacking him, I just cannot stand Sam Smith.
Can I lay by your side next to you?
I just don't get it. I do not understand the appeal of this guy, not one little bit. Every single song that I've ever heard from Sam Smith has been nothing but a slow, tired, lifeless dirge that drains the energy out of the room and just makes me instantly sad. His voice is so overwrought in pain that it drags me down every time I hear it. And not in a good way, like where I feel and share with and can relate to the pain. I feel no emotional connection to any of his work. It's just an aesthetic. A miserable, gloomy, depressing aesthetic with no purpose to it. At least when Post Malone or Khalid or even Drake sound sad, they're trying to sound more low-key and spaced out. They're not demanding attention to themselves. They sound relaxed in their melancholy. Sam Smith, meanwhile, sounds anguished and tortured as he belts out these horribly overwrought wails that give me flashbacks of some of the cringier Bruno Mars songs. Not only are his songs miserable to get through, but because they're so anguished, it's impossible to ignore a Sam Smith song when it comes on the radio, which, by the way, is a phenomenon about as common as grass where I'm from. I know that this is just a personal opinion, and I'm not expecting anybody to agree with me on this, but I can't think of any singer who's gotten big in the past few years that I dislike more than Sam Smith. I debated whether this song or I'm Not the Only One should take this spot, and it was close. I'm Not the Only One was and still is a radio menace, but at least it has an interesting melody and some decent lines. Meanwhile, The Bridge of Lay Me Down is probably the best and most energetic that I've ever heard on a Sam Smith song. However, The Bridge still lasts for less than a minute of this 4.5 minute slog, and the rest of it sees Sam Smith constantly switching gears between dribbling whimper and soul-sucking screeching, with almost no instruments whatsoever to distract from his voice. It doesn't even matter if the lyrics or concept of this song is somewhat emotionally effective. It doesn't matter if I hate the way that it's being delivered. Sam Smith, please do me a little favor and never put out any music again. Unless someone offers you a feature credit, because whenever you're on someone else's song, you miraculously become remarkably enjoyable and compelling. That's all I ask of you. Just that one little favor.
Now we dance. We dance.
I'm sure by this point, most of you guys have seen Todd in the Shadows' version of this same video, the Top 10 Worst Hit Songs of 2015. Spoiler alert if you haven't seen it, but the song he put at number one on his list was Marvin Gaye by Meghan Trainor and Charlie Puth, a song that I personally don't really care about. That said, I do completely understand why he put it on his list, as well as why so many other people put it on their lists too. I can see why so many people found it insulting to attach the name of the greatest sex god in all of R&B to a song where Trainor and Puth provided a duet that would make Tony Tennille say, "Okay guys, this is a little too white for me." However, I think of it in the same way as Ray Schremer calling themselves the Black Beatles. It's just some kids trying to sound cool, or, you know, whatever their approximation of that is. Without that, I think the song is no worse than mediocre, so it's not going to be appearing on this list. And besides that, there was one other thing that Todd said about that song that I strongly disagree with.
All I can tell you, this is one of the most inexplicable songs I've ever heard.
Okay. So, let me get this straight, Todd. You're saying that Meghan Trainor and Charlie Puth making a 50s doo-wop ballad where they attempt to wrap their heads around the concept of coitus is something that you didn't expect, but this is something that you can explain?
Shoulder sideways, smack it in the air. Legs move it side to side, smack it in the air.
Now, here's someone who I don't feel bad punching at.
Way on, way on.
If you're looking for one of the most inexplicable songs ever written, all you have to do is look at 2015, when Beyoncé, the musical auteur and pop culture icon with a highly revered career that had lasted for a decade and a half at that point, decided that she would release a Vine dance song. Yes, Queen Bee's imprint onto one of the best years in music history was a trap song chock full of auto-tune, simple dance steps, and one of the most mind-numbingly repetitive sets of lyrics that you will ever hear in your life. I don't think it's hyperbole to say that Beyoncé in the 2010s is one of the last artists who I would ever expect to release something like this. I'm so reckless when I rock my Givenchy dress. Whether you love her or you hate her, it's impossible to deny that until the day she dies, Beyoncé will be one of the most famous and successful artists on the planet, because fame and importance are just part of Beyoncé's image at this point. I've mentioned before that Beyoncé is great at adding a sense of larger-than-life grandeur to a song, and that's because she seems to have taken up the mantle as the face of womanhood and female empowerment over the past decade. She's more of an icon than a person at this point. So to hear Beyoncé release a song like this is mind-blowing, not only because it's so bad, but because it's so completely lacking in ambition. This song doesn't sound like something made by one of the biggest and most important entertainers on the planet. It sounds like something that Bad Baby turned down because it didn't use the C word enough. It is bleedingly apparent that the only reason that Beyoncé put this song out was to hop on a trend. A trend, might I add, that was driven almost entirely by teenage boys fresh out of high school. Beyoncé has never sounded as much like a woman in her mid-30s trying to relate to the youth as she does here. I mean, this is basically the auto-tuned version of this. You ain't gotta worry about nothing. Worry about nada. If you're sitting in class and paying attention. I would go into more detail about the song itself, but there's really not much to analyze here. I will say this though. When I saw this song appearing on a few other people's worst lists, I thought, based on the short clips that they showed, that they were being too harsh on this song. And if you're thinking that right now, then trust me. This song doesn't sound so bad in little edited snippets, but listen to the whole song, and 30 seconds in, it'll start to feel like an endurance test. It really is impossible to properly describe with words, so go listen to it if you haven't already. I assure you that it is a transformative experience. And if you don't want to listen to this song alone, then don't worry, I've got you covered. You see, I forced Casey to listen to this song, I recorded his reaction, and I attached it to the end of this video. So you can go listen to it with him. It'll be fun.
You want fucking barbecue sauce all over my- But this is where I draw the fucking line, Sean!
It's gonna be fun. 7-Eleven is the single most inexplicable song of 2015, but even among the inexplicable, it's not the worst. To find out what songs managed to dig even lower than this one, be sure to check out part 2, coming soon. I'm Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond X Studios, thank you guys for watching, and if you'll excuse me, I'm gonna go pick up some milk from the mobile station. God knows I am never going to 7-Eleven again.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again. We've come a long way from where we began. Oh, I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
Hi, I'm Casey. I'm Sean's younger brother. He wants me to watch this video. Spin it well, my hands up, yeah! Fuck, why is it Christmas now? She's so obviously not drunk.
Alright, so, did you notice how-
Fuck you!